Welcome to the tutorial, how to use the Keep It Simple Habit Tracker review pages. This is third part in a series showing you how I intended for the Keep It Simple Habit Tracker to be used. You can use it any way you like, but this gives you some basic groundwork about what I intended. The review pages come after the weekly, daily pages, after you've completed 4 weeks of the daily pages, and after you've completed 12 weeks of the daily pages. And I'll show you what that looks like. Tracking your progress with periodic reviews helps you know if you're making any progress, gets you out in front of your game, and lets you know where you need to adjust as you move forward. All of these things, again, are printed in the Keep It Simple Habit Tracker. Or you can just copy them right off the screen because YouTube has a pause button. So the weekly review, a little bit of this I changed because I didn't like how it worked. So now I have listing the liabilities that you most struggled with. That's the first question here. And then the second one is listing the assets that you seem to succeed well with in the last 7 days. This covers just the last 7 days of your life. So what I've written for the liabilities that have the most check or X marks for me, the one I struggle with the most all the time, is being self-centered. And the ones that I did really well this week was acceptance and surrender. Then it says write a little bit about each liability. So basically you take the word self-centered and you write what that meant. How did you experience self-centeredness during your week? I found myself thinking less about others. I was obsessing on a video game, squeezing in time to play, even having it be my first waking thought. That's self-centered for me. I'm not thinking about other people. I'm thinking about me first. And when you need self-care, that's very important. But as a general rule, when I think of myself too much and I'm not thinking of other people, I tend to get all my other defects take off. I'm writing a little bit about each asset, so I just picked the first one, acceptance. I recognized that challenging trait of self-centeredness. I accepted that maybe something was going on with me that needed addressing, something I don't want to look at or deal with, so I'm choosing the video game distraction instead. Because when I'm playing a video game and it's my first waking thought, it's a cue that something's going on that maybe I'm wanting to avoid. That's just me. During the past week, it also asks the question, I faced this challenge in my recovery, my life, or my relationship. I put the example of moving to a new town. I was feeling homesick, avoiding new meetings because I didn't want to make new friends. I had 18 years in my previous hometown, and this was very unfamiliar to me, and I don't like change unless it's on my terms. And this was, and it wasn't, because I thought I knew what I'd expect, and I didn't. So the next prompt is I called my sponsor or a trusted friend, and I talked about my challenge. It also asks, if I didn't, why didn't I? If not, why not? I did call my sponsor. I talked to my husband also about my feelings, and we all came up with some solutions to this challenge that I will try this week. On the next page, it says, I made progress in working toward completing my main thing in this way. Earlier, our main thing, we outlined step work. I think what I'm using for my main thing at this point is the challenge, but I made time for my step work. I met with my sponsor and I honored my commitment to my sponsees. That's just general information, but that's how I deal with my main thing when it's finishing my step work. I allowed this to get in the way of my getting closer to my main thing. So this week I allowed my fear to get in the way of my progress regarding new meetings. You know, even though I found one, I didn't go. I freaked myself out about it. They call it getting up in your head, I think. So the next prompt is I completed my morning routine all days, some days, no days this week. And if not, why not? So yes, I did complete it. Sometimes I write, I got 5 days out of 7. Sometimes I'm like, I've had a really off week, did not finish any of them. And I write down why. Maybe I'm having a heavy emotional week, or I just feel way off, or I'm not dealing with my stuff. I also include, I attended my regular meetings. I have regular meetings that I attend regularly. So when I'm missing them consistently, why am I missing them? I said, I attended 3 of my 4 meetings this week. I had a dinner date with some neighbors at the same time as one of my meetings. So that week I skipped it. I also include a question about taking care of our mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being and how we do that. So I include 4 lines because it doesn't have to be a novel. And I just write down what I did for physical, what I did for emotional, what I did for spiritual, and what I did for mental. You can put them in any order you want. You can put all of them, some of them, one of them. It's up to you. This is just space for you to kind of check in with yourself. I always like to put down what my favorite moment was in the last 7 days. And it's because there always is one. And we tend to focus on all the shit we did or all the things that didn't go well or, oh, what a fucked week. Sorry. That's why this isn't for children. But I think it's important to write down favorite moments, to remember that there are good times, even in the midst of challenges. And mine happened to be rescuing a hummingbird that knocked itself senseless after flying into our window. It was a really special moment. So that was my favorite moment for that week. I also like writing what I've learned about myself, because when I pay attention, when I increase my self-awareness, I learn more about myself, even if I don't like what I've learned, because it gives me something to work on and correct if it needs to be corrected. Sometimes I find something exciting and wonderful, like a talent that I didn't really know I had. What I learned about myself, my example here says, when I experience hurt feelings, I tend to blame others for hurting my feelings instead of owning my feelings and changing my story. The hurt is usually triggered from the past, and I need to look at that past trigger instead of spending my energy blaming whoever's knit closest to me. Sadly, that's my trait. You might not have that trait, but I find that it's easier for me to blame somebody else than to look at why I allow something to happen or why I don't allow something to happen. And then it's always important for me to check in and address how I can show up differently next week to be a better me. I can practice thinking of 3 other people each day and reaching out to them either by phone or by text, thinking less of myself. When I feel the urge to play that video game, I can check in with myself to see if it's for fun or avoidance or both. So this is how I use the weekly review. I do all those daily pages, and then I have written all that stuff down so I can look back and I can see maybe where my favorite moment is, what days I struggled and what I was struggling about, if I attended my meetings or not. Usually the wins for the day also is me listing what I got done. So then at the end of a 4-week period, that's 28 days, there's a 28-day review. And I made this one fun. I'm skipping the first 2 paragraphs. If you have the book, you can read it. If you want to read these, pause the video. The 3rd line says, we'll make this fun and simple on a scale from 1 to 10, 1 being the least and 10 being the most. How did you do on these things? And then it asks you 10 questions. The total would be 100 if you did every single thing 100%. I never have, not once. I don't think I ever got below 50%. I think 60 has been my lowest. But the questions have to do with all that stuff you did during the month, almost a month, right? So every evening I fill in my main thing, my action list, and my appointments for the next day. Well, apparently 75% of the time I did that. I review my daily affirmations and my why daily to maintain my momentum. I do that less. I completed my morning routine, including my gratitude list every day. Boom, 100%. And then you just go through these, completing the actions for the main thing, mentally review the day and do my inventory, write the wins for today every evening, celebrate my progress, writing in my journal, answering the review questions from the week, and practice showing up a little differently. And so the next step, now I've circled all these, this reminds me of when I was really young and used to do the Cosmopolitan quizzes, then you add them up, right? So let's add up my score. I got all these numbers because there's 10 questions and the total was 82. 82 is pretty good, actually. I'll tell you, when I started doing this, it was in the 60s. So then I've got 3 sections on this next page. If your total was 10 to 39 and it tells you what the result of that might be, it says you may need to review your why and your interest in your main thing. Maybe you need to change it. Maybe your why is not strong enough. If your total was 40 to 69, maybe you need to focus on discipline skills. So you've got the list down and you know what you want to do, but you're not doing it consistently. And that's just about changing habits. And then if your total was 70 to 100, while you may need minor route adjustments, you appear to be right on course. And then it gives you a little pep talk at the end. Mine was obviously 82, so it was between these two numbers. That's how you do a 28-day review. And this just gives me an idea of if I'm doing the things I intended to do, and it gives me my own little pep talk about, do I want to keep doing this? Do I think this is stupid? Do I see it as a benefit and I just need to keep doing it to get in the habit of this? You get to decide what you want to do. I put the last paragraph, says, frankly, I once lived a life of mediocrity and told myself I was excelling. Totally the truth. Today, I can be honest with who I am, what I want, and what I'm willing to sacrifice in order to live in the sunshine of the spirit. I also get to go easy on myself, make a little bit of progress every day, and be kind to myself when I have a rough day, which is true. This is the 12-week review. I did this because it came at the end of the book, and I just felt like it pulled the end of the book together, right? So you do 12 weeks of tracking your behavior, your activity, what you want to do, how you want to be better, and did you do it or not? I had this inventory chart. I think it's important to review the 10-step inventories over the past 12 weeks. You've only got 3 tabs. You can look at them and kind of see where you were excelling, which character assets you were rocking, because some of them can be removed. You can change this list at any time when you feel like for me, honesty and dishonesty, I don't lie to people anymore. I don't even fib to people. I think the most I will do if someone asks me how I am is tell them I don't want to talk about it right now. That's honest, and I don't have to lie. So I can remove honesty and dishonesty off my chart. I'll replace it with something else, but I decided to take this section out. So if you have this section in your book, you can complete it. It's a little tedious, and it didn't give me the results that I thought it would, but I already had printed these books, therefore I couldn't really remove it. Because it would make everything else weird. So there you go, cross that out. And then once again, you can modify these questions that you ask yourself. It's a final review of how you're doing with your basic character traits. Are some of your liabilities more prevalent at the end than they were in the beginning? Are you acting out more? Are some of your assets more prevalent at the end than they were in the beginning? I tend to think that if we keep looking at them every day, they're going to get better. And when we see a challenging time, fight with a spouse, child acting out, trouble at work, your assets are going to be a little less prevalent and your character liabilities are probably going to shine a little more. That's just the way it is. So it also says, have some liabilities lessened or faded away? And in the past few weeks, have you noticed any new liabilities surfacing? Because as we do this longer and longer, the character traits that we don't want to practice become more subtle. To us, they're not obvious. To somebody else, they might be. Maybe you're rolling your eyes a lot and you don't even feel it because it's so second nature. But somebody else might be reading that and not appreciating it. It's, you know, it's about increasing our self-awareness about who we are and how we want to be. If you have any new liabilities, you can list some new assets that you might want to replace those liabilities with. And then we also talk about our main thing down at the bottom of this page. You write your main thing in, obviously, and it says, have you made progress toward or completed your main thing? Well, I put yes because I finished my steps. And then you write some highlights. I'm not going to fill all these in for you. This is all for you to do. You write down your progress highlights and what's next. Like, do you have a new main thing? Or what's left for you to do to complete this main thing? Again, we ask how you might avoid the action. Has it taken you a really long time? What's a good example? Okay, I wrote a book. And when I was writing the book, there were some ways that I avoided taking action. Because it was hard, it was scary, I was kind of stuck. They call it writer's block, but the bottom line is it was very emotional writing, and I didn't really want to do it. So I had to write some of the ways that I was avoiding taking action. Why was I putting things off? It says, why do you think you're stalling on your progress? Could any of your liabilities be part of the issue? Main liability for me was fear of looking stupid, of it not being good enough. And then it says at the bottom here, review your why. Is it still relevant 12 weeks later? Like at the beginning, 12 weeks ago, you wrote down why. Does reading your why motivate you to continue on tough days, or do you need to update it? And you get to write what it is. And then there's some more reading for you. And then finally, it says, what could you do differently in the next 4 weeks to 12 weeks to either move forward in your main thing or your recovery to your satisfaction? And you just, basically, you're journaling. I've given you a page just to write, yeah, I worked, I did a great job, things are going great. Or, you know, maybe if I did this differently or I talk to somebody because I don't have the skills to complete the thing I'm trying to complete, I'll reach out to those people. That's scary too, but you can do that. And that's how you do the reviews. I hope you found something helpful in these tutorials for using this recovery journal. Keep in mind, once again, these are only suggestions. You can use as much or as little of this journal as you choose. It's your recovery. I'm happy to answer any questions or clarify anything I've recorded here, so please feel free to add a comment below. That's under the video here. You can also contact me through the website under About, although that's not actually true. If you go to Your Best Recovery Life, at the very bottom of the page on the right is a little, it looks like a little talking bubble. Just click on that and you can send me a comment, or you can just comment here under the video and I will look and I will respond. Thank you for your time. I hope you enjoyed this series of videos on how to use your Keep It Simple habit tracker, and I look forward to hearing from you. Thanks.